Morning.
Are you jealous of my holiday sweater, David Lee Scales?
I totally am. It's the perfect color for the holidays, too.
It really is.
Nicely done. Yeah. I'm so sad mine doesn't fit. I should probably hit him up and get a bigger one.
You definitely should. While you're doing that, give me an extra large.
Okay, will do. I'm going to open the show with a listener call.
Okay.
And then we can start by discussing it.
Salad days, referring to the beginning of your life, you know. The famous punk band, The Descendants, album or song, when they were young. Salad days referring to the beginning of your life, you know, as in if you have a meal, a big meal, you have the salad before your meal. So salad days, you know, your life is the meal. It's like the beginning of your life is the salad days, you know, it's all fun. Okay, salad days, beginning of your life. It's like a meal. Peace out.
Salad Days is Minor Threat. Salad Days is not The Descendants. I'm about to drive off the freeway right now. You guys are killing me.
There you go. Spoken word poetry by our listeners.
That's going to be the Grit's first Spotify top 100.
You think?
Yeah, I think it's gone. I think that one's going all the way to the top. But that's really funny, Minor Threat guy. I was always thinking about Salad Days, I was thinking, I don't remember The Descendants on that. What movie was it again?
Voluptuous.
Yeah, I didn't remember The Descendants. But yeah, I'm glad that the record stands corrected there, too.
It's been months since I've received such impassioned feedback about a subject. This past week, no less than a dozen DMs, emails telling me that The Descendants did not make Salad Days and that it was Minor Threat.
I mean, nobody cares like new punk fans, like fans of new punk from the mid 90s.
Mm-hmm. So that call that ended that message was the first one that came in, and it was almost like an hour after we published the episode. The guy, there was actually more at the end of the call that I cut off because he was insulting the previous caller, calling him bad names and a stoner and stuff. And I was like, we don't need to include that. But I was like, you're absolutely right. I don't know if I said it was The Descendants, but certainly the caller did. And then I just went with it. In my head, it wasn't fully jiving. I just didn't call it out. So anyways, people are pissed. Salad Days by Minor Threat.
Record corrected.
Let the record show. But what do you think about the remix?
I mean, the remix, I'm telling you, that thing is going places. That thing, I can totally hear it now on K-Jazz Radio. I think that's where it'll get its start before it hits the mainstream and then just runs up the Spotify.
Do you think it needs to be on mainstream terrestrial radio? I feel like it could just exist virally.
I mean, it can exist there too, but it's got such a sweet rhythm to it that I'd want the average gal driving home from work, flipping on the radio, to be able to experience that themselves.
That's true. We don't want to eliminate old timey radio listeners. This could definitely convert not. Them. This could convert them to actually Spotify. Days,
you know, I'm a straight up old timey radio listener.
Are you?
Yeah. Oh man, that's all I do.
I didn't know that.
I am a classical KUSC on all cars dials.
Okay. I didn't realize. Is my video shut off?
Yeah.
Sorry. No worries. There we go.
Yeah. I was just looking at the little icon that whole time.
Oh, wow. Okay. Let me know if there's any ever any technical difficulties like that. All right. Well, hey, thrilled to be back. It's almost Christmas. It's December 16th. This is David Scales with Chess Smith.
Right around the corner, David Lee. Right around the corner.
You're wearing your beautifully holiday green athletic greens sweatshirt.
I'm so happy to have one. I squeeze myself into it, even though it's a solid size and a half too small, but I like it so much that I just wear it. You know what I do when a sweatshirt's too small? This is going to be a helpful hint for people.
Let's hear it.
Because you know how you'll have that sweatshirt that is too small in your wardrobe? Everyone's got one, right?
Yeah, you used to love it, but it just doesn't quite fit anymore or something like that, so you hang on to it.
Precisely. It's tight in the arms. The tight in the arms always looks good with a too small sweater. Where it looks dumb is around your waist where it's riding up too high, right? So yeah. What I do is flip the bottom elastic part, whatever, just the bottom of the sweater, flip it up halfway. So you wear it sort of like a half sweater. And then people don't know or wouldn't know. They just think, look at that guy. He's like fitting that sweater real nice. They don't know
But then it looks like you're trying to show midriff or something.
No, but you have a t-shirt on underneath.
Okay.
So yeah. So it just becomes like that's precisely how I wear this one. And I feel it becomes just sort of an iconic look that you can hold on to.
Interesting.
Yeah, I recommend for those out there who have a too small sweater, flip up the bottom.
So this is kind of like pulling up a pant leg.
Exactly. It's a little signature, but this one is way more functional in that it allows you to hang on to that sweater and wear it longer and longer. Like I'm wearing my too small athletic green sweater. You are not.
That's very true. I've never put it on after I tried it on once.
Yep.
So I'm wondering if athletic greens sweaters, which I don't think they're available on their website. It's not like they're selling merch, but I'm wondering if they made them small to kind of body shame us to lose weight. Yeah.
The problem is they're like too small though. Like, I mean, they're asking for diminutive people to fit into their sweaters. They're not asking necessarily for healthy people. That's what it feels like to me.
Okay.
It's not a healthy person. It's a emaciated person.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah.
It's a little haberdasher could actually wear the appropriate sized one.
Yep. Exactly.
Well, athleticgreens.com/surf is our promo code. Are you done Christmas shopping, Chaz?
Yes, because family is headed to Europe on Sunday afternoon. So that is basically the Christmas shopping.
That's a pretty darn good gift.
Yeah.
Are they taking you with them?
They're taking me with. Yeah, I get to go as well. So, but man, talk about the stress. I got, last night was at the theater till probably 10:30, 11. Tonight it'll be the same. Opening night Friday, double feature Saturday, Sunday matinee. Got to get from Escondido to LAX to fly to Italy. But in like, I think show will end at 4, flight leaves at 8.
Oh my gosh, dude.
Uh-oh, yeah.
That is brutal. Are you stressed out?
Yes, very much so. If you see me on the freeway on Sunday, please get out of my way.
Yeah, that's brutal.
Yeah.
Wow, that's a lot to unpack. First of all, how's your rehearsal going
for your ballet? Yeah. Last night was the first night in the theater, the first full dress rehearsal in the theater. And something else, I'll tell you what. It is to see I was never a theater kid, I don't recall ever really being backstage anytime.
Yeah.
But to see sort of the machinations of how it works, the stagehands and everybody. I mean, there's so many stagehands, like figuring out which curtain to pull up when, like you just take that stuff for granted. So all that is happening. Then all of the, you know, I mean, the cast is huge. So all the dancers out there doing their thing and costume changes and, you know, a whole nine. It's a big deal.
And how's your performance coming along?
I think my party dad performance could use some more work, which I'll get another chance tonight to work on it. But I think my Mother Ginger is pretty good. I think I'm pretty solid as Mother Ginger. I've got my makeup dialed, I think.
Wow. Okay. So you're relying on makeup, but not
basically
not choreography.
Basically.
You said you'll get a chance to practice tonight. Are you not practicing at home?
No, heck no. Like, cause it's the party dad scene. I'm dancing with my party wife. And so it's sort of hard to, I mean, I suppose I could. And I suppose one of the dances I'm just dancing by myself. So yeah, I should be practicing at home, but I'm not.
Other dads are practicing at home.
One, I definitely two of them are. I see them come prepped and ready, and they'll even go into the practice room and work on their steps, where I sit with my sweatshirt half flipped off, chuckling at them, and then get on stage and realize.
I don't think nobody's expecting greatness out of the dads in this performance.
No, that's the thing. I think the dads are given a lot of leeway. So as long as I don't basically like run into somebody or fall down,
right,
I think I'll be okay.
Right. Okay, good. So I didn't know you were going to Europe. Did this just come up, or were you guys planning this?
Yeah, it's been in maybe a couple weeks, 3 weeks.
Good for you. Gosh, I'm so jealous. I talked to Scott Bass on Tuesday, and he's like, I talked to him last Tuesday. He had no vacations on the books. I talked to him this Tuesday, or yeah, a couple days ago. He's like, oh, I just got back from Mexico. I went on a 3-day surf trip with Taylor Knox. I'm like, what the heck? Who are these people that just drop everything and go? Europe's even more extravagant.
Poland triggers. Man, though, it's with the new COVID restrictions, it's like twice as stressful. Like the daily emails of changing restrictions, stuff we need to submit, all this kind of stuff. So on top of everything else.
Are you meeting with anybody there, or are you just going as a family unit?
Going as a family unit.
Good for you. That is amazing.
Yeah, going to Shred, Italy.
Okay, snowboard trip.
Yeah.
Where are you going?
Cortina, in the Swiss Alps.
And then, so you're not bringing any gifts?
I mean, bringing some for the children and bringing one for the wife. But aside from that, it'll just be kind of shopping there.
Awesome, man. Can you say what you got your wife?
No, I cannot. Okay.
Not can you tell me next? Can you tell me next week?
I can. Not that she'll ever listen to the show, so I might as well tell. But just
is it extravagant?
It's extravagant. It's her 50th, so it's an extravagant gift.
Wow, dying. Yeah.
But what are you doing for your first Christmas as father?
I can't reveal any gifts at the risk that somebody might listen, but we're staying close to home. So all of our family is local, essentially. So we're going to go to my mom's house for Christmas Eve, where extended family will be. And then we're going to go to Lauren's family's house for Christmas Day, which my family is going to come and join there as well. So we'll all be together for 48 hours, just at two different locations.
Is there any holiday tradition in either the Scales or Lauren households that...
Nothing. Yeah, nothing out of the ordinary.
Are you Christmas Eve present openers or Christmas morn present openers?
Because of the nature of divorced families, you get to do both.
Uh-huh.
There's been times where I have four different houses that I've got to be at, you know, because your partner has two divorced parents, then I have two divorced parents, and not everybody was getting along at those times. And so it's like you start Christmas Eve at noon opening gifts, then you go somewhere else for the evening, and then you go somewhere in the morning, and then you go somewhere Christmas Day afternoon. So it's a 48-hour event.
Does it feel good, or do your wrists and forearms get sore from so much present opening?
You don't get tired from present opening ever, I don't think, but you do get tired of being on the freeway during holidays.
Yeah.
And so I kind of always knew, and I even told my parents, hey, you guys need to get your acts together and start getting along, because this will not last. When I have a kid, like, there's no chance that we're going to all these different places. And thankfully, they all sorted that out years ago. And I would prefer that everybody came to our house just to see the kid, but it's a lot of hassle to host, you know? So it's just kind of more convenient to bring the kid, pack him up, and just take him there for a few hours. But the great news is having a kid allows you to get out of the place at a reasonable hour. We'll come, we'll do 4 hours, and then we're out of there.
Whenever you want. Gotta get him down. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Classic.
Exactly. Okay. I've got a couple listener things that we need to address. This one comes from longtime Beach Grit lurker, first time emailer. Kind of gives a long paragraph. I won't read it all, but basically he was talking about Tudor Watches is now sponsoring the Nazare event and the Jaws event as well. So they are kind of the sponsor for the Big Wave World Tour. Were you familiar with this?
I was familiar with Tudor and was also familiar as of a few days ago that they were a sponsor of the Nazare event. I guess I didn't know that they were a Jaws event sponsor.
Yeah, I don't think they really announced it, but I did go to the website at some point and they happen to be written in the text. Do you want to explain who Tudor is to listeners?
Well, I've always thought that Tudor was like the poor man's Rolex. Like, you couldn't afford a Rolex, so you got a Tudor. Is that correct?
The company, I don't know. I didn't do the research, but the companies are somehow connected. I think I don't think that Rolex owns Tudor, but I think at some point Tudor was getting their movements from Rolex, like the interior workings of the watch were coming from Rolex. But there's also, for some reason, the Tudor case itself and the actual design of the watch look like knockoff Rolexes. Yeah. Like, they have the same Submariner, they have the same, I don't know, whatever else. I'm not sure what that connection is, but
I'm excited for listeners to correct, but that was always my impression, that the Tudor was your starter Rolex if you were trying to step up into finer watches. But Tudor, I don't think, is anyone's ending spot. I don't think you get a Tudor and think, yeah, got a Tudor watch.
They're still expensive. They're still $3,000 watches, you know, $5,000 or something.
Sure. That's an expensive watch. But
if you're using the Rolex movement, is that they're buying from Rolex is probably driving the cost up, obviously.
It's your starter watch, though, I think, which is
gotcha.
Yeah, odd. I mean, I guess it's not odd. I guess maybe they'll want to appeal to their tough guy. I mean, I just don't know who buys a Tudor. It's a weird segment of the market for me to think there's a bunch of people who are willing to spend $3,000 to $5,000 on a watch, but are not willing to spend $10,000 to $15,000 on a watch. Like, at that point, what's the difference for me?
It's a good question. To me, I would think they're more functional. So are you going to take your Submariner diving? You know, and the reality is it's very functional. You can take it diving, but do you want to lose potentially a $10,000 watch? Well, you might feel more comfortable taking your $3,000 Tudor on a dive trip.
But truly, if you're diving and you're not going to die and you have a Submariner and you're going to dive with it, that's awesome. But if you're not going to dive with it, they have a bunch of great dive watches, like for $500, that are actually super functional, awesome dive watches.
Okay. Well, this listener is a self-professed hopeless watch nerd. And he said, barrel or no, wearing a luxury watch to the gym.
I'm going to go say wearing any watch to the gym is nah, to be honest.
What about an Apple Watch that tracks your stuff?
I mean, no, because you shouldn't have an Apple Watch. You should be having a Whoop strap around your wrist.
Promo code surf.
Yeah, no, I mean, definitely gyms are already showy-offy, right? I don't go to the gym. You go to the gym now. But I feel that there's an element of gym going that is showing off. And so adding more elements of showing off, i.e. a designer watch or an expensive watch, seems like an unnecessary many steps too far.
Yeah, I envision so many of those expensive watches now are so big, you know, like that it's almost eliminates your mobility of your wrist. I was in yoga class one time years ago, and this guy came in not dressed for yoga and had this giant luxury watch on his wrist, and you need all that mobility. He's going into downward dog and the watch is like preventing his wrist from bending. And also you're sweating a ton. So if it's not a metal watch, if you had like a leather watch, it's just going to stink it up. So I think I'm with this guy. This guy actually gave his answer. He said he's a staunch no on this one, but he sees it all the time. Guys wearing $5,000 watches into the gym. Silly. Where I think you're right. It is kind of a meat market, so that's probably the play for those guys, but it's lacks functionality.
Silly. I think thankfully the massive watch trend is over. Gracefully, I think it's passed. That was such a horrible trend. I don't know how anyone thought that was a good look to have a watch that would dwarf your wrist, even if you were a bigger guy.
Yeah, I think maybe this isn't where it started, but I could see like Jason Statham or The Rock wearing, you know, a 44 millimeter, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And then other people who love that celebrity, they're like, I want that watch, but they're not 6'4" and hulking, you know? And so it just doesn't look right on the wrist. Well, anyways, this listener has another one. He said, barrel or not, wearing your luxury watch in the lineup?
I'm barrel on that one. not, I think your luxury, like, okay, if your luxury watch is your everyday watch, like if you have a Rolex and you wear it every day and that's your watch, then wear it in the lineup. I wear mine in the lineup.
You do, you really? Which one? Sure.
My Rolex. Rolex?
No uh-huh. way.
Yeah.
Why?
Because I don't take it off very often. I mean, it's broken now because I wore it in the lineup, but not the watch itself, just the band broke and I got to figure out just how to get a new band on it. But
that's yeah. the problem is if the band breaks in the water and you lose a $7,000 or $10,000 watch, that's a nightmare. Why not just take it off?
Because like, it's your everyday watch. Like I think protecting like your nice stuff in your life is meant to be used. That's why you got it. You didn't get it to like, theoretically good stuff or expensive stuff is built better. And so take it through its paces. That's yeah. what it's for.
Well, I think that's all true, fine and good up until you hit the $10,000 mark. Then I want to start gingerly treating stuff.
Yeah, but still like, and then so you lose it. That's there's some luxury in tossing away a $10,000 watch.
You know who, I want to be the kid on the beach who finds your Rolex washing up in the lineup. That's who I want to be. Well, so speaking of the Nazare event, there was a big story from Nazare that somehow nobody, including yourself, wrote or talked about. And that is the gender blended category.
Yeah, it's true. It's funny. I only thought about it. And when I was doing my story a couple days ago, and I was like, oh, there was actually guys and girls in heats together. But then I suppose it was a non-story, I feel, for me, because they weren't like, at that point, you're just competing in windows. It's not like those big wave surfers are necessarily, the heats are different in big wave surfing, right?
Yes.
I mean, they are competing against each other, obviously, but there was still a woman winner and a man winner. They were just, correct. They were just overlapping heats.
Correct.
Essentially.
Yes. Well, I don't think there was enough women to create an entire category, yeah. like a women's division. So, and it's all partnered. Obviously, you're on a ski team, so you have one surfer, one driver, and you could trade off. But it was a male and female on a team. For the France team, I'm trying to look it up real quick. The Brazilian team had a woman.
Maya Gabiera was there.
Correct. So it might just be Brazil and France that had women as part of their team, but I think they do an overall, they do the most committed award is not distinct to gender. That could be male yeah. or female, but they do have a best men's performance and a best women's performance, and then a best team performance. So that's not unique to gender either.
I felt that, the WSL was way more confusing than they needed to be in terms of explaining the process, who and who won, right? Like
I couldn't even find a winner.
No, that I didn't know if Kai Lenny or who was he, Lucas,
yeah,
his partner, I did not know which of them won until I still don't know who won. They won as a team, and then Lucas won the individual, right?
No, I've got in my notes, I have they won as a team for the second year in a row, but Pedro Scooby won as the individual.
No, I think Pedro Scooby just had the ride that everybody liked and the
he
highest
had the most
ride.
Committed.
Yeah, but I think
yeah, that, you're right.
See, but how can the fact that we don't know automatically that it's not listed directly up, winner team, winner men's, winners women, or winner women's, and most committed. Pedro just had the ride that everybody talked about, I think.
So Pedro got the most committed award. You're okay. Absolutely right. Pedro got the most committed award. Kai and Chumbo, yeah, got the best team. Justine DuPont got the best female performance, and then Chumbo got the best male performance.
But that was never ever stated clearly in any of the WSL press.
No, and I actually went to their website to dig it up on Monday just to prep for the week, and I could not find it anywhere. I ended up finding it on their Instagram. They posted individual winners on their Instagram. But on their website, they didn't have it listed. And then when you go to the results from the event, it doesn't list it there either, which is super, super strange.
I did the same exact thing. Wanted to write a quick thing about it, wanted to get the winners, and could honestly not find it. And so just sort of guessed that Kai and Chumbo won as a team, Lucas won individual, and Justine, I didn't even know that there was a committed or whatever award.
Well, what's interesting too is that we didn't know that those were even the categories that people would win in prior to the event. You know, it's like, why not in advance explain what's what? I guess maybe if we were watching the event from beginning to end, the commentators would have been discussing that, but nobody's really watching that event from beginning to end.
And that's the other thing is I'm tied in here. Like my Instagram feed is filled with surf stuff and my obviously inbox is regularly peppered with emails from surf companies and brands and whatever. I didn't hear until after the fact that thing even ran.
Like, so you didn't watch it live?
No. Whatever marketing they did on it somehow missed me.
Yeah.
Like, I guess I should have been paying attention, but I should have also been inundated with it's going live, you know, Instagram, whatever, like stuff.
Yeah. Marketing. I wasn't inundated, but I was aware. Like they talked about the green light for 2 or 3 days in advance, which is kind of how much time they have. 3 days, I think, is the general amount of time. But they called it on for Sunday and then woke up that morning and the swell was there, but it was foggy all day. So they couldn't run the event on Sunday. So it went on hold and then ran on Monday where the swell had dropped a little bit, but it was crystal clear.
How much did you watch live?
None.
Yeah.
I wasn't interested to watch live and I feel like watching the highlights, digging them up after the fact was totally adequate.
Yeah.
How do you feel as... about Tudor watches as a fit?
Well, it kind of works, I suppose, because I don't know the person who buys a Tudor watch. I also don't know really the person who is a big, huge fan of big wave surfing. I think everybody, of course, is a fan of, like, well, exactly like you say, like the highlights of it and watching it, or watching big waves be ridden. But I don't know the person who flips it on and watches all day.
Right.
Like, so in terms of a fit, they're both communities that I don't understand.
It's funny. I think it's a good fit as well. Not for the same reason, but I just think it's a good fit. Like, I think it's great to expand outside of our little endemic surf world. And I feel like those watch brands, they sponsor Formula One cars, they sponsor golf, they sponsor, they've got money to spend, you know, like they're heavy marketers in other realms. And so I like having them associated with surfing.
Do you think that they spent very much and or anything?
I have
the
no
winner
idea.
Does the winner get a free Tudor watch? And that's their investment. They get title sponsorship on that.
I have no idea if they do or don't, but they, I would hope, worked into that contract is that Tudor can use a lot of that imagery, because when you see a guy on or girl on the face of one of those waves at Nazare and that little Tudor logo next to it, that's incredible imagery. You know, like, well, they could put that on a poster and sell dive watches with that image.
I totally agree. And I think that completely, even though I don't know what their market is, I would imagine that would appeal to the market of a man in particular looking for to make a statement kind of thing, like where, oh man, I got the watch that is associated with, you know, all these brave men and women who ride giants.
100%.
Hunker mountains.
So I had another thought while watching the event, and that is, obviously it's a super dangerous event and there's just so much water moving and it's a lot of frothed, aerated water. And then you see the skis and it looks like Waterworld. It's like a gladiator arena with skis flying over, you know, backs of waves. And the guy who did the floater was just absolutely insane. And then Kai Lenny on the back of Chumbo's ski, wiping out and getting kind of sucked over the falls. It made me realize the skis are the most dangerous element in this contest. And I feel like they're the ones that will result in a death at some point at Nazare. Whereas when you see like the surfers getting killed in big surf hasn't happened in a lot of years. And it's largely because of the rescue teams, but I'm wondering if now the rescue teams might actually be the culprit specifically at Nazare. They could be more strategic everywhere else, but at Nazare, it feels like that's where the big accident's gonna happen.
I mean, that's the thing though, is how many lives do they save versus, you know, like all the lives that have been saved via ski at Nazareth or anywhere else, but specifically Nazareth. Imagine probably countless lives saved with use of ski, right?
Totally.
And so it's, yeah, when one takes somebody out, it would be a huge bummer, but you can't, it's not like you can get rid of them.
You really can't. And I don't know. And these are the best ski drivers in the world. So actually, I don't want to throw any shade, but the ones who end up in peril, like the floater that we saw, it was a guy who I had never heard of before. And I'm sure that he's well-known in the big wave community, but he's probably not the same caliber of ski driver as Chumbo and Kai Lenny, you know?
I mean, man, would you be more stressed out or paranoid out there being the driver or being the guy getting towed?
The driver, for sure.
Oh man, if somebody said you have to go to Nazareth and surf big, we'll give you a choice. You can either drive the ski or be towed in. I would be towed in every single time.
For sure. And I would insist that Chumbo, Garrett McNamara, or Kai Lenny were my drivers.
Yeah.
You know, like I wouldn't, because that's the difference between life and death out there, is a good driver whipping you into the right wave at the right speed, getting out of your way, rescuing you when you need, you're going to ultimately need to get rescued out there because there's no paddling to the channel. There's no paddling, period.
And then
on a towboard.
I mean, that wave, like what used to be considered, I know it's Stab, I think, did a story about it, used to be considered a giant burger, and now everybody recognizes that it's the most dangerous or one of the more dangerous waves in the world. It's, you know, good for Nazareth to man up over the years.
Well, it still is a burger on the outside waves. You just want to aim for the ones that aren't that outside burger, you know?
Yeah.
Go for the insider. Are you impressed by the chop hops? Are we bringing the chop hop back?
I've always liked a good chop hop. I've never had anything against the chop hop, to be honest.
Okay.
Do you like it?
No, I don't like the chop hop.
I don't like the chop hop on small waves.
Yeah.
I take on it big back. Waves. I don't even mind it there.
Really?
I'm a chop hopper. I mean, no, I think I've done one before and thought I did an air. We considered it a radical air.
If you try to do it off the lip, you can fool people into thinking that it's an air, but usually it's done on a flat section. And out there, it was done on the flatter kind of part of the wave right as they were taking off before the wave broke. But it does add an element of pizzazz to the ride. I just don't think it adds an element of something that's hard to do.
It's exactly, but it does, like, I think it shows, I like to see comfort in True. Crazy situations. It's feels always to me on a big wave, it feels a lot like a snowboarder dropping in and then going switch, or dropping in switch and going regular straight out of the run, right? Like a big mountain. I guess they do it in half pipe and stuff too, where you start one way and then you quickly hop the other and off you go. That's the way the chop hop on big wave surfing feels to me. Very snowboardy.
That'd be amazing if somebody held it fakey for a while. Like if Kyle Lenny just, because they were going for height. They're like doing a giant exaggerated motion. And I think Chumbo's, where he pulled into the tube afterwards, was even like a full rotation chop hop. It'd be incredible if they just did a mini 180 and then rode fakey for a bit just to show how much control they have and then spin it around and go.
Completely. I hope they take notes. I hope all of the big wave surfers are taking notes right now of how to look better.
I hope so too, because we know. All right, I've got another listener line call.
Hey, David Lee, this is Bob. I've been listening to The Grit 143 with you and Chaz. Thinking about that Corpo Speak inertia event going on, and I hear both of you. I think that there's this kind of feeling that everybody's had it up to their gills with that kind of goody two shoes, look at me, I'm doing everything perfectly type of deal. And I'm wondering if people burning down the surfboard racks at Waikiki might be like a byproduct of that sort of deal. Like if everyone's just had it up to here with, okay, everybody who's selling something to you happens to be doing the best shit in the world, the counterculture might be saying, fuck that. Let's go completely the different direction. light boards on fire, pour gasoline on your local beach. I don't know. I think it creates a scary precedent for people who don't feel it. Curious if you guys have any thoughts. Thanks. Love the show.
Great insight there.
Do you follow that thought? It was a little bit...
I mean, that's, I think, which I probably didn't even speak it as well as he did last week, but the frustration that builds even in me from seeing real performative dishonesty over and over and over again does get annoying, right? And I could see how, I mean, it does make me, it makes me want to go kick stuff, not dogs, but other stuff. And I could see how the SERP world in general, if this greenwashed, false, you know, we're all, like he said, we're all the best people in the world or whatever, doing the best things in the world, keeps getting shoved down. I totally could see how a violent reaction would be like, screw all this. I want to break windshields and wreck stuff. I mean, that's where punk came as a reaction, yeah. I suppose, to, you know, I don't know if my historical interpretation would be correct, but of the, you know, glam, everything's wonderful, disco era, 70s, like so much excess to burn it down, where I could see that the inertia being disco era surf that is going to get torched by punk, by Minor Threats and the Descendants.
Yeah, I think of specifically with punk, I think about London or like the UK, you know, where it was just so prim and proper, where you have the monarchy and like everybody kind of aspiring to that. And punk was like a direct opposite of that in the way that grunge was here in the 90s, where it's like, just make the most ugly music, most ugly sounds with your guitars possible, wear ripped jeans and don't, you know, bathe or whatever. But as it relates to surfing, it is an interesting point, and I hadn't thought about it. I think it still exists societally today, maybe not in music, but there's a lot of the chaos that we're seeing in society is a result of a disenfranchised community. And that disenfranchised community used to be a minority, and it's slowly swelling into a majority where you can follow all of the rules. You can go to college, even get the degree, spend all the money getting the degree, come out of college and there's no jobs available, or there's only $40,000 a year jobs available, won't allow you to pay back your student loans. And so I think people are feeling that they were sold a bill of goods and lies. And as a result, them and 20 of their friends are getting together and they're smashing into a Crate and Barrel and grabbing everything they want and then just bailing because you guys all lied to me. Screw you guys. This is all a joke, you know?
I mean, totally. And as it relates, I suppose, to the inertia and their thing, like how many years can you be performatively good and not actually doing anything before people are frustrated and furious by that? Like, screw you guys. And I guess that's not the majority surf thing, so the analogy ain't quite apt, but
I think it is
growing resentment and frustration at stuff that has been presented and is just not true, I think is the unifying thing. Not that the inertia is not trying to be good, but what are they doing? They're doing nothing. They're continuing to make product. They're continuing to pollute the earth just like everyone else.
I think it'd be a real stretch to draw a line between what the inertia is doing and somebody lighting surfboard racks on fire in Waikiki. But I think what we all kind of just feel is that the inertia is creating content that does not resonate with you or I in any way, shape, or form. But they seem to be growing an audience. And that audience, who doesn't have discernment to identify a chop hop off the lip versus a proper air off a lip, they're the ones who are showing up at the beach with a soft top next to you and I, making the parking so crowded that we can't find a spot, and then battling for waves. And then when we get a wave properly, they're the ones burning us or back paddling us or whatever. And so we're identifying that the Val community at the beach is somehow generated by the inertia. And that's where we're getting upset at.
The when you go to the inertia website, like what, you know, sign up for our mailer pops up thing. And it says like, it's like a set wave or something like that. It's free for you. It's such a representation of anything surf. Like, let's all get on the set wave together. I can't even remember what it says, but it's something like, it's just like, it's like getting hooted into a set wave, or it's like worse than that, because it's not hooting in. It's like, the set wave is yours, take it.
What about Laird's documentary or book called, it was his documentary called Take Every Wave.
Love that. I love Laird doing that. Laird can and does do that.
It's amazing though.
It really is. Yeah, that is Laird saying, I properly don't care what any of you think in the core surf community.
It applies to him and nobody else. And
it applies to him and what's the dude's name who went back for his tofoil redemption?
Oh my gosh, yeah. Yeah, I forget his name now. Jeez, I think he has three names. John something something.
Let me go look. It's worth it.
I sent it to you yesterday, didn't I?
Yeah, Derek wrote about it.
Okay, John Van Tesmar.
That's it. John Van Tesmar. There he is. We know him now.
So we knew him before. I just didn't want to out him previously.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So John Van Tesmar, this is kind of a story. Posted an Instagram and even titled it, after my last session, this is my redemption session is what he wrote. And he said, after my last session here where I lost and had my board broken by some angry locals, I came out this session wanting redemption and I got it. And it's a video of him, toe foiling into another wave at Fort Point on a sizable day.
The amount of lack of self-awareness on that, like not realizing that, you got your board smashed because you were literally endangering everyone there, doing something that nobody else is doing. I didn't see one other boat towing out there. It wasn't a tow day at Fort Point. I didn't see any surfers paddling in his video. Did you? No. There must have been some, but maybe there wasn't. But it's absurd to think, like, tied back to the inertia style thing. So checked out of the average surfer's mindset of, you don't do that because nobody else is doing that, right? If this is not a tow spot and it's not a tow day, if it was both of those things, and like at Jaws, right? Where you can have the mixed days where there's people paddling and people towing, but they all know who has priority, right? Like, yeah. or the ones who are good. And there's order, and there is, in a lineup like that, there is retribution if you get out of line, right? That's what keeps Jaws safe.
Yeah.
So not knowing any of that, being a, what is he, a kite surf instructor?
Oh yeah, I don't remember. He claims, and other people have actually told me, he surfs as well, like longboards, and surfs pretty well.
That's all fine. Kite
surfs, yeah.
But he clearly doesn't know the etiquette. There's no place on earth that I've ever seen one person is allowed to choose to toe foil a session when no one else is. Like,
right.
It's dangerous. It's mean. It's rude. The people out there don't want to hear this boat buzzing around. Like, part of surfing is not to hear that, right? Like, that's to have the quiet or just the waves crashing, whatever. To have a boat out the back is so annoying.
Yeah. When this happened, I got a lot of emails and feedback from people who surf that spot all the time and have surfed it for decades. And I had to parse through a lot of it to decide kind of, I don't know what objective this person has or what angle they come from. And my concern was, I see everything from the view and the lens of being a shortboarder in Southern California. And so I feel like, well, things need to happen for the benefit of me. And then we'll kind of allow these people in if they're respectful of the way that we do things. But maybe in other places, you know, the kite boarders have priority or the longboarders have priority or whatever. And ultimately, after parsing all the information, what I kind of came to understand about this was there are boats that are buzzing through that lineup all the time, just by the way that that spot's positioned. And there are people even kiting that spot all the time. And then there's people foiling that spot. And there's even a couple of people toe foiling that spot. But they generally, the proper etiquette is to catch that wave well outside, because on a foil you can.
And kick surf out.
Kick out before the wave starts to break. And then that's where this proper kind of paddling surfers will take, ownership from there, so to speak. And that one situation, got out of hand because he was riding a new foil board that he wasn't used to, and he didn't quite kick out, or there was a surfer paddling out in the path that he wanted to kick out. So he had to angle inside, and then he got stuck on the wave and had to dump the foil. And that's how the foil ended up on the beach. So it wasn't, it was an anomaly, and it wasn't what he intended to do, but they can coexist out there in harmony. They just didn't in that moment.
Well, way to get to the bottom of the story right there. It feels like a fine analysis.
But I still agree with what you said. And I think that they shouldn't be doing it out there because, or he shouldn't be advertising his redemption session. Ultimately is what I feel about.
He definitely shouldn't be videoing it. And like, look at me do this thing. Like, that's not chill.
Exactly. If there's that much, the way that I explained it, if there's that much nuance, and it really is then just, you can't be advertising your, you know, outlier situation or activity to the broad market being like, hey, because next week, a bunch of other people show up thinking that they can do it as well.
Well, so especially in the day and age of Mark Zuckerberg on a foil where you're in San Francisco and you have a ton of tech dudes who are there thinking, oh, I want to do that too. And have enough money to afford all of it. All of a sudden there's 15 boats with tow foilers out there. You have no idea what they're doing.
Yeah, totally. Matt Warshaw, I was asking him about whether he watches Ben Gravy's vlogs or Mason Ho's edits or whatever. And he said he watches some of them, and what he likes or what he dislikes, and how he kind of divides what he'll watch and what he won't watch, is if somebody is doing something performative directly for the camera, he cringes and he doesn't like it. No matter how good that person is surfing, it just feels wrong.
Artificial. Yeah.
Yeah. And so Mason Ho might be seductively explaining his surfboard to the camera. But if you were there on the beach, Mason Ho would be seductively explaining a surfboard to you because that's the way he talks, you know? So Mason gets a pass, and Mason would be surfing all that stuff, whether there was the filmer there or not. Whereas, you know, the John Van, whatever his name is, that we were just talking about, him talking into the camera being like, hey, I'm here to get my redemption today. This is what that feels like. Okay, now you're just doing this for views and for clicks and to build your audience and all that. And it's at the peril of the 30 other people that are in, and the 30 other people who are in the lineup, you know?
Yeah.
The other thing that I felt like, I gave that example of those smash and grabs that are happening this year, where they bum rush a store with 20 people. It's like, of course you can get away with doing this. If you get 20 people to bum rush a store, you can get away with stealing from that store. Maybe all 20 of you, if not all 20 of you, 18 of you, the odds are pretty good, are going to get out of there. So John Van, whatever. Yes, you can get away with foiling. That doesn't make it right. Like the only thing that makes us a civilized society is the fact that we can certainly do all these things around us and get away with them, but it would be inconvenient for the other people that are living in this society if we all behaved that way. Sure, I could drive 100 miles on the freeway and probably get away with it, but it would be, we can't all drive 100 miles on the freeway. You know, we have to kind of agree to a code of conduct and a code of ethics. And if you step outside that code of conduct, it inevitably infringes upon, because we're living in these tight quarters, sharing resources.
There would be no, I don't think it's against the law at all for me to paddle a or a Zodiac out into the lineup, a big old boat, and just sit there and kind of catch waves and get it rolled and have it wash through the lineup and do it again and again. Like,
right.
But that's very rude to everyone else.
Totally. I was in Trader Joe's yesterday afternoon. So pretty crowded, you know, the calculus that you run in your head when you're trying to pick which line to stand to get out of there as quickly as possible. Dude, I found the primo line. Every line had like five people in it with like full baskets of stuff. I found the primo line. It was one dude already checking out, and he had 9 of his items already checked with 1 item left. And I'm like, sweet, swoop right into that line. Well, once I get into line, I hear him talking to the cashier, explaining, oh, my wife wanted this item and I couldn't quite find it. And the cashier's like, well, want me to go back there and check for it? He goes, yeah, you would. Oh, you know what? And my daughter actually wants the chocolate covered frozen bananas. I forgot to grab those as well. She goes, you know what? Let me just go look for you. The cashier leaves her post and is now walking through this crowded store. I'm standing there going, what the hell? Like, there's no chance she's back in 10 seconds. This is a multi-minute mission. And meanwhile, I'm watching the other lines around me go down. And I was just like, this MF-er. I have been in this guy's position before where I'm literally paying and I go, oh crap, I forgot to get something. You know what I do? I finish my transaction, go back into the store afterwards, grab what I need, stand in line and go through the whole process again. This guy made me wait.
The person who, I mean, it really is, especially at a anywhere at this time of year, but at a grocery store, blood boiling. When the lack of awareness of people around you, like if you're going to inconvenience someone, unless you hate the people around you, right, unless you really actively dislike them, inconvenience yourself. Like do just, completely, you know, ask her, hey, where is this thing? And when she says, I'll go look for it, say, don't worry about it. Take care of this guy first. And then, you know, I'll go find or call up a manager or something to help me. Like there's always a way to, yeah, just to be thoughtful. People are, the lack of awareness is intense.
Or on the freeway, not the freeway, but on the road, I'll see it oftentimes. Somebody will be in the left lane, but they wanted to make a right turn. And rather than like, oh, it's my mistake, I'll go past the light, do a U-turn, they'll stop in the middle of the road, try to cut across, make 10 cars hit the brakes, install what they're doing in order for this. It's like, no, you made the mistake. You suck it up.
Yeah. But
I have, in my head, I was really trying hard. I was like, okay, who's the asshole here? This is a mistake that people make. Am I being intolerant? And I, you know, I could very easily show some grace and be like, oh, it's the holiday season. I don't mind. I do have 2 minutes to spare. I'll just wait here for 2 minutes. No big deal. How's your holiday season? Make small talk with the guy. Or is he the asshole for even inconveniencing one other person for 2 minutes?
I think that it all depends on the, again, self-awareness. If he looks at you after sending the cashier scampering and says, I'm really sorry, like, you know, whatever. If there's some self-awareness that what he's doing is rude, then it's all fine and good. And if you held the grudge, then it's on you, right?
Yeah.
But if he's totally unaware that he's being a nuisance to his fellow human, then it's on him.
Well, I don't know if he was self-aware or not, but he did not apologize. I'm thinking he was aware and did not care.
Yeah.
So
I guess that's another category of, if you're really a proper jerk, then good on you. If that's who you are deep in your heart, and if he looked at you and said, hey, buzz off, you're in my space, then it goes back to him on being cool.
Well, I waited about 45 seconds and realized the line next to me was moving real quick and that person was checking out. So I quickly jumped into that line, got out of there pretty quickly. He got out of there before I did because that cashier did come back, check him out. Or I think she couldn't find the product actually. So like he was already done with his transaction. So he walked out of the store 30 seconds before me, but I thought through a method of retribution and I was like, here's the deal. If that dude is parked anywhere around my car, I am going to camp out right behind his parking spot. Like say he's the car next to me, I need to unload my groceries. My cart is going to go right behind his car so that he cannot exit. And I'll slowly take my groceries out. I won't even take my groceries out. I'll just stand there and wait until he says something, be like, hey, why don't you move? I'll be like, oh, guess what, buddy? Payback.
Yep. Classic is also, you could back out and box him in and then just start texting people. Just sit on your phone, totally unaware, just writing some emails, writing some texts. It's always good.
Totally thought about that too. But then also like didn't quite have the energy to engage at that level and then never even saw him again once I got out there. But I ran through all those scenarios in my head.
Yeah, it's good. It's good.
All right. So should we go into everyone's new favorite category, which is True Grit or clickbait shit?
Yes. The list of names was great.
There were so many, and I don't know that this is even where we land, but I like True Grit being a part of the title.
Yep.
So True Grit, this is the segment where I just read Chaz's own headlines back to him. And he either defends them as true grit or they're just clickbait bullcrap that he's trying to peddle to us. Okay, here we go. Quote, World Surf League shocks media watchers by inking stunning two-year deal with largest commercial television network in Latin America, celebrates by tooting racist dog whistle.
This was a good one. This was good on a couple levels. So initially I thought them inking a deal with Globo TV or TV Globo, whatever, the second largest, whatever TV thing in Latin America, and the second or first in Latin America and the second largest in the world after ABC, I believe. So
wow,
big. I thought that was just clickbait because I didn't care and didn't care. And, but in the comments, somebody made, a lot of times clickbait will turn interesting in the comments of Beach Grit. Said there was no mention in the press release of money changing hands. So that is interesting, right? Like, it's not like who paid who, sort of. Is the WSL paying TV Globo for its audience, or is TV Globo paying WSL for its content? That kind of thing. It would show maybe a little bit of the state of professional surfing. Right. And so I thought that came to be interesting to me in the comments. But the racist dog whistle, I'm going to say, is legit. Like, how many times has Brazilian fans been called passionate, or Brazilian surfing? It's like shorthand for Brazil that I think has been overused so much that it is now a racist trope.
Well, I didn't think
black people dance good or something, right? Like, if every time a black actor or something was mentioned, or, you know, black people in general, and or a black audience, and it said these great dancing folk are, you know, da 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 da. That's the word passionate, always, always with Brazilians.
So
when coming from the American surf side.
Oh, so I didn't read the article, but how did they use the word passion, or what was the racist part? When did they use it? How?
It was just like in the first paragraph, and it was just said something like, you know, World Surf League is very excited to share all this content with this passionate fan base.
Got it.
But like, how many times is a group of people described one way by another group of people before it becomes problematic, right? Even if you're using it well, even if you have good intentions behind it, but why not use another word? Why always passionate? Brazilians are passionate.
Yeah,
from
you're right.
Perspective, it becomes great.
I don't know how many times you can use it. That's a great question. And it has to be used exclusively by an other ethnicity.
It's not Brazilians calling themselves passionate. It's a white person, always, and specifically in surf, a white surfer or white surf company calling this other brown fan base only ever passionate. Never say
and always specifically to leverage their own interest is what it is.
Totally. Precisely. I mean, so again, funny headline, but I think there's real truth there. I think it truly is, you know, obviously they weren't intending on being racist, but, and I know Brazilian is not a race of people, and so it's not officially racist. It would be whatever else, but I know they weren't intending, but that's, like, rarely are people intending to be racist.
Well, intention has nothing to do with it. If you are, you know, if you feel deeply in your heart a certain way and it's revealed through your manner of speech and the words that you choose, that's the definition of racist.
Like, why couldn't the WSL have said, like, the well-informed Brazilian fan base or whatever, right? Like,
dedicated.
The dedicated. There's a lot of other adjectives or anything that they could have used to describe besides the only one that is ever used, which is passionate.
Start a countdown calendar. Year 8, day 242 of the WSL using the word passionate to describe the Brazilian fan base.
After this podcast, thinking about it more, I think I'm going to demand an apology from the World Surf League on behalf of Brazilian surf fans.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Well, that's why they can get away with it, is that nobody's going to complain about being called passionate.
Well, that's the thing. But, you know, people shouldn't get complained about saying, oh, you know, they jump really high or they dance good. You know, like, they're all...
Well, they wouldn't. I mean, that's like the example you chose.
But they're all positives. But once they become a defining characteristic, again, to define an other, then it becomes problematic. It's like straight tokenization.
Okay, black dudes complaining that they've got the stereotype of having big wieners.
Yeah,
I'm sure. So tired of this, man. This is so lame.
And the individual may not, but as a group, though, that like it says, you think of us in this one way, or these really limited ways. You don't think of us as a group of people, right?
Yeah.
Which I think
I get what you're saying.
The Brazilian fan base could so say, you don't care. You don't even know us. We are samba dancing crazy people in your mind, right? Like, that's all we do. We get out at carnival and whoop, 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 whoop. Like, that's all they are to the WSL.
Yeah. I get what you're saying completely. I just don't see that complaint being voiced.
I'm going to voice it. On behalf of the of course. Brazil, on behalf of you, I have you. I'm a champion.
That's your job.
Yeah, a champion for job. Brazil.
The voice for the voiceless.
Yep.
Okay. Article. So, by the way, is that True Grit or is that clickbait bull?
Say True Grit.
Okay.
Racist. Right,
article number two, tooting racist dog whistle. article number two, quote, professional surfers praised as boldest athlete activists on earth by newspaper of record. They jump headfirst into denouncing ghastly human rights records and use public profiles to focus global attention on such issues, end quote.
I was just as shocked as anyone else. I'm going to say this is True Grit as well. The Washington Post truly had a story. I guess it was an opinion piece, but so it wasn't a real story, but and a long opinion piece on how surfers have led the way for as athlete activists for so many years. That it was in context of World Tennis Association pulling out, or the women's WTA pulling out of China, over complaints about how
superstar tennis player.
Yeah, superstar tennis player who alleged that she had been sexually harassed, and just the story got buried, and I think they disappeared her for a while. China did.
Did they find her again?
Yeah, that she like came back out and gave like a super tepid, everything's okay, like a clearly like, you know, under duress, or I don't know if she's under duress, but you know, you can't really, unless she was in America or somewhere else without Chinese handlers around saying, yep, all's good, I stepped out of line there, whatever. But I mean, I think the whole thing just reeks. But then, yeah, the article, well, I didn't see it coming, pivoted into the great history that professional surfers have in standing up and denouncing human rights abuses for all history.
Wow.
Yeah.
Awesome. What examples did they give other than Tyler Wright and Black Lives Matter?
They gave, started with Martin Potter, Tom Carroll, and Tom Kern boycotting South Africa.
Perfect.
They didn't have that many examples, actually. It was that one. And then I think there was a lot of Corey Schumacher boycotting the ASP, I think, in general, over there holding an event in China, a longboard event. And then it was Tyler Wright. I think those are really the three examples they gave.
Fair enough.
So I'm going to say clickbait on that, just because I'm going to say the Washington Post made clickbait, not Beach Grit. I was just reporting on reporting. But it didn't seem like it's great. I like it did give meat, I suppose, to particularly the Martin Potter, Tom Carroll, Tom Curran boycott of South Africa, and how important that was at the time. And how you know, apartheid is clearly such an evil, and you sort of, I suppose I take for granted that everybody was kind of boycotting, but nobody was. Like, right. for them, it wasn't like universally boycotted by athletics, you know, sports leagues and whatnot. And so for those guys to really do that was a profound statement.
Totally. It seems like people could pretty easily ignore it if they wanted to at that time, you know, even though it was happening, it was like, over there, it's not part of us. So I think it was a pretty big move. Awesome. So, okay. That's a real story then. And what does newspaper of record officially mean?
Newspaper of record is a newspaper. I think I don't know if there's a specific amount of, or a number in the circulation, but it's like, basically a national newspaper that what its opinions or its stories changes or directs the public discourse. So like New York Times is a paper of record. Washington Post would be a paper of record. It's probably, I don't know, maybe the only two.
Yeah, well, and this was written by the Post, you said?
Yeah.
Okay, because the fact that your headline said newspaper of record rather than the name of the paper made me feel like it was not a newspaper of record.
Yeah, I don't know why. My first headline there was Jeff Bezos' organ.
Jeff Bezos' organ?
Yeah, by Jeff Bezos' organ. And organ, O-R-G-A-N, is a, like a publication. No, it's a publication that broadcasts out like usually one person's thoughts or opinions.
Got it, or a
organization's thoughts and opinions. But yeah.
Okay. All right. Final article, quote, face of modern surfing, heir to Mickey Dora's Malibu throne, Jonah Hill excoriates Sex and the City's Carrie Bradshaw for not immediately calling 911 after husband suffered fatal heart attack whilst riding a stationary bicycle.
Yeah, this was a reach here, I'll admit.
Was it more of a reach than Peloton shares plummet after Sex and the City's Mr. Big dies riding one? Surfers mourn, in fact, that he wasn't straddling longboard instead.
Well, that one I really wish that he was. I just saw Peloton's shares plummet and thought, man, what if he had been on a sup or something when he died? How awesome would, like, the sort of people who would stop surfing because Mr. Big died on a surfboard, any kind of surfboard, are the exact same people who should stop surfing.
Well, so they went to the Inertia Summit. They went to the Evolve Summit on Friday, watched Sex and the City on Saturday. So they were like high as could be on Friday to go surf. They surfed Saturday morning. Sunday yep. morning, never seen again.
Never. They sold their soft top. Yeah, but the Jonah Hill one was straight poor clickbait. I was really sitting around with apparently time on my hands and no good things to write.
Did you see this morning the news that Chris Noth, the actor who plays Mr. Big, is busted for sexually harassing women?
Uh-oh, on set?
They didn't say what set, but yes, it said a number of, it was a US Weekly article or Instagram headline. And it was like Chris Noth in hot water. Multiple women have come forward accusing him of sexual harassment.
Oh, dun, dun, dun. Man, well, this sounds like another Beach Grit story.
We'll find a way.
Yeah.
Are you watching Sex and the City's new series?
No, it's funny. I watched... I watched it. I've probably seen every episode of Sex and the City at this point. Like, I'd always watch it on airplanes and stuff when it was on airplanes, or like it was just like the kind of mindless brain candy. That show is aged maybe poorer than any show in the history of shows. It is a cringe a second now to rewatch. Not only the, like, I read some article about the reboot, and they said the original series, or they describe the original series as just gay men playing with Barbies, which is exactly what it is. Like the overall, it's like just a gay male vision of what the female experience should be is so profoundly horrible to watch in retrospect.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
That is so funny. So yeah. I thought that's what women were actually into at that moment in New York.
I think they were actually into it at the time. Like, I think any or many women, you know, when it was live, I don't think it was seen as cringy as it is in retrospect. Like,
of course,
nothing I think people is, thought, right? Oh, this is cute and this is fun and this is a, you know, a celebration of powerful individual females as opposed to, you know, moms and whatever else is on, you know, typically on TV. These are all working women who, you know, self-empowered, da, 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 da. But in retrospect, oops, nope, it was just Barbies being played with by gay men.
That's so funny. Real life Barbies.
Yeah.
So funny. Okay. Well, Jonah's watching. So
yeah, Jonah is watching.
All right, let's go to commercial break and we'll come back with the closing Barrel or Not.
Let's do it.
All right, Chaz, welcome back.
So exciting.
I know you're going to be in Italy next week. Are we going to try to record?
I think next week might be tough, but the week after will be good.
So I'm not going to see you before Christmas then.
I don't think so.
Okay. Well then, we'll have a couple of Christmas questions for you in this week's Barrel or Not.
But yeah, I mean, maybe. Let's try to make it happen. Let's play that one by ear.
Okay. I can make it work, but I fully understand, and I think our listeners would understand as well if you cannot. Not only are you in Italy, but you're snowboarding, so that's inconvenient to try to record during.
There's chairlifts. There's gondola rides.
So our first Barrel or Nah comes from the aforementioned John Von Tesmer's Instagram post of him having his redemption session at Fort Point. Barrel or Nah, sticking your tongue out when the camera pans to you.
So no barrel. Opening your mouth when the hamming it up when the camera pans to you. I would have said, especially in advanced age or an older person doing it, but I'm gonna say anybody. Any kid who like wags their tongue, opens their mouth, strikes a pose when the camera passes, be self-assured. I feel awkward when the camera passes. I know I'm making a dumb face, my natural face, which will be looking dumb. There's no way to hide it. Just own it. Own that you are not comfortable in front of the camera and don't goof it up to try to pretend that, look at how comfortable I am in front of the camera. Yeah. Be stiff. Be weird.
Yeah. So in that Instagram post, John is on the ski or on the foil on the back of the boat. There's a driver of the boat and then there's the filmer. So the filmer's filming John behind the boat and then kind of pans as he lets go of the rope, catches the wave, and then comes along the side of the boat. And in the foreground of that shot is the driver. So the driver sees that the camera's panning at him. And he's like, sticking his tongue out at the camera. Like, hey, look at me. I'm a wild and crazy guy. I'm just driving a boat. And it's like, I felt the exact same way as you. I'm like, dude, you're 50 years old. Why are you hamming it up? Why are you doing this?
Yeah. Why are you being such a goofy kid?
Why do we feel a need to do that? You know, I understand the need that he's feeling because I feel that need as well. Keep your mouth closed. Nobody wants to see into your mouth.
It's the feeling of I'm awkward, but just stay there and be awkward. Own your awkwardness.
Totally.
It was the dad filming. Did you know that? It was that dude. It was the boat driver's dad on camera.
Man, if you're liable to get punched out, don't bring your dad to witness it.
No, and don't announce like old whatever three name guy, foil guy. He like announced everyone and did like a big presentation before the thing. The lack of awareness again that people might be angry at that, and now you're making other people potentially putting a bullseye on them too.
Yeah,
this is the guy who's whipping me in.
Yeah. And by the way, they stick out their tongue at the camera.
Yeah.
all right. Yeah. We're going no on that. And that's helpful advice for anybody this holiday season, because a camera will pan past you at some point in the next week.
You are going to feel the urge. Just maintain whatever position you're in. Don't change.
Nobody wants to see your tongue, and nobody wants to see your fillings.
Nope. You can smile warmly.
And there you go. That's the most. I'll willing to look at your teeth, but not your tongue.
Yep.
Barrel or Nah, tipping or gifting your mailman?
Oh, this is a good one. I'm going to for sure barrel. But it's harder in this day and age because I feel my mailman changes a lot.
Yeah, I had that same question too.
Yeah, but I think whichever person is delivering the mail that day, I think it's a wonderful gesture to leave something in the mailbox.
So is cash appropriate?
I'm going to say cash is always appropriate, but I'm going to say cash is weird for the mailman. I'm going to say a little thoughtful gift, a trinket.
What would that be?
A Tudor watch.
So a $3,000 gift.
What would be good? A subscription to athleticgreens.com/surf.
Fantastic.
Just a little card. You're giving him help. That guy's out there in the cold, in the wet, a blazing sun, or a girl. Give her the gift of health.
Or a Whoop strap, a Whoop 4.0 strap so that they could track their steps and monitor all their activity. These are great ideas. I can't believe we just thought of these.
I wonder, just think the strain on a mailman. I bet it's pretty high.
Yeah, they're carrying around the Outer Known catalogs to everybody. I mean, they're carrying so much junk out. How would you feel if your job, if you knew 99% of what you were delivering was complete junk,
literal
junk mail and utter nonsense that had zero meaning, effect on anybody, or value?
That only went from his arm to my mailbox, my walking to the recycling bin and throwing it all in there.
And in one decade of doing your job, you went from doing the most important job in the neighborhood to now doing one that only has 1% efficacy or reason or purpose, you know?
If that, but that's the problem too, is that one thing. Like, I'm generally pretty terrified, or not generally, but often if I'm expecting an important piece of mail, then I'll really flip through the junk mail to make sure that it didn't get lodged there somewhere. Like, if I'm not expecting any important mail, I just take the whole mailbox and dump it into the recycling. But if I'm expecting something, ooh, the terror that you're going to throw it away with the junk.
But these people, mail carriers, literally had a super important job one decade ago. They were like bills, payments, like everything was coming, important messages from loved ones, sentimental love notes, you know, everything
information
passing through their hand. Yeah, crazy, right?
And now it's junk mail.
But I do think they deserve a gift. I absolutely think the cash is okay. I don't know what the appropriate amount is, but I feel like if it was the same, minimum, I'd say $100.
But yeah, I guess so. But I hear you. 20 is cheap, but 20 as the minimum is a good starting point, because nobody's sad if that's all you got. Nobody's sad at getting a $20 bill ever.
Right.
You could be annoyed at getting 15 or 5 or 10. Yeah. You'd be like, what? Just leave that. Yeah. Keep it yourself. You apparently need money more than me.
Well, it's an interesting dilemma where a certain amount of money is interpreted as an insult.
Yeah.
15 or $1, certainly, you'd be like, what?
Yeah.
But it's still a gift. It's still 15. I'm still slightly offended. Why is it 15? Why is it a round number? It should be a 20, you know?
Yep.
All right. So we're going barrel on gifting for your mailman. So everybody get that sorted out in the next week. Final barrel or not, dressing up as Santa for your children.
Oh, I'm going to say barrel. I think anything that you're going out of your way and doing something awkward and uncomfortable and something you would not do otherwise for the chuckles of your children is a barrel. Like, I've never done it.
Yeah.
And won't. But any dad who does, good on you. Going to get the costume, putting on the beard, getting the pillow up in your red jacket, all to make your children happy. Like, the amount of struggle and annoyance and frustration and pain for the amount of happiness that it makes is like all time high on struggle and for pretty minimal happiness. But any dad willing to go to that much trouble for just a laugh is a good dad.
I think I'm going to implement this, not this year, but in future years, because there's a real hassle and inconvenience in taking your kid to the mall to see Santa. You're standing in line. Santa is, a stranger to them, you know, like there's no familiarity. Their kids are often scared by him. But in your own home, and even if your kids are too young to identify that you are Santa, I think they understand a certain level of comfort. They can identify a certain element that is comfortable. And this was a trope in every Christmas movie I watched as a kid. Sometimes it was the uncle, but often it was the children's own father who was dressed up as Santa. And it's like, where did they explain that dad went when he left the room 15 minutes ago? I guess he just went to the store. Oh, and unfortunately, Santa came by right in that window when dad was at the store, and the kids aren't savvy enough to do the math. But I like it. I'm all into it. I'm going to do it.
Great. Yeah. Great. Recommend.
All right. Good luck getting a Santa outfit for your children in the next week, but if you can, do it.
Definitely.
All right, Chaz, great show. Beachgrid.com is where we get the headlines from. These are the stories behind the headlines.
Yep. It's important to know the stories themselves are so deep that it's important that we spend another hour and a half unpacking them.
Agreed.
Yeah.
And athleticgreens.com/surf, whoop.com promo code surf are our sponsors. And at surf journalist is your Instagram handle. Minor Threat sang Salad Days. And should we hear some more of that remix real quick before we go?
Let's
out?
Do it.
I think we should. The amount of time spent creating that remix warrants a little playback. And by the way, I did not edit this guy's call. This first like 10 seconds of the kind of record scratching was remixed, but the rest of the call is played in its entirety, which is hard to believe.
You know, Salad Days referring to the beginning of your life.
From this point on,
punk band, the Descendants album or song, when they were young, they, you know, Salad Days referring to the beginning of your life, you know, as in if you have a meal, big meal, you have the salad before your meal. So Salad Days, you know, your life is the meal. It's like beginning of your life is the Salad Days, you know, it's all fun. Okay, Salad Days, beginning of your life, it's like a meal. Peace out.
Him hanging up the phone and the fumbling is part of the call.
For the fact that it's not called from a actual telephone, not a cell phone.
Right, because you can hear the fumbling. So yeah, that I did not edit that call. That is how it plays out in its entirety.
That's so awesome. Good on whoever made it.
So you want to know what my Christmas gift is to all of our listeners?
Yes.
I'm going to upload that file into the podcast feed separately. So you can go to Spotify and in our list of episodes, boom, Salad Days remix will be right there.
Let's get that onto Spotify's top 100.
Let's do it.
Do your part, listeners.
Play it for your family this holiday season.
Yeah.
All right, Chez, good show.
Great show. Talk to you next week. I'm going to make it happen.
All right. Have fun in Europe. And until then,
get barrel.